Welcome to this edition of Backstage Pass with Leah Chang. Tonight, I am at ACT of Connecticut in Ridgefield, Connecticut, for the opening night production of Sunset Boulevard, starring Pearl Sun as Norma Desmond. She is making history as the first Asian American to play Norma Desmond in the United States. She stars opposite Michael Burrell as Joe Gillis, George Xavier as Max Von Meyerling, and Helen Shen as Betty Schaefer. Ariel Estrada and I celebrated the opening night of Sunset Boulevard at ACT of Connecticut, and I had a chance to sit down with Pearl at her opening night party.
You know, Daniel C. Levine, our director and artistic director here at ACT of Connecticut, and his husband, Brian Perry, who's our music director. I have had the great fortune of working with both of them several times, and they're dear friends of mine, and they actually approached me to play this role, and it was never on my radar. I had never even dreamed of it, because I just could never imagine that this was an option for me as an Asian American female. And when they presented it, I said, can I take a moment with it and look at the material? And so I took a couple days to look at the score and kind of think on it. And I responded and called them back, and I said, look, it would be the most rewarding and challenging artistic experience, I think, of my career. And I welcome that challenge, so I would love it to work with you and do this.
I just graduated high school, and Glenn Close had done an out-of-town tryout in Los Angeles, and I got to see that. And it was with Glenn Close, Judy Kuhn, George Hearn, and I remembered, I don't remember the details of the production, but what I do remember is just being in awe of the grandeur, of the scope of it, the scale of it, of her performance in particular. And that really impacted me. And cut to 30 years later, here I am, and having this opportunity, and I'm really proud to be able to do this and hopefully inspire other Asian American actors to keep pursuing their dreams.
In the dark.
making.
This is actually a historical moment to have the two of us as Asian American females playing these two roles without any sort of question about it, any sort of having to validate it for whatever reason. And she's fantastic in her role. And I'm just so proud. Where it did impact me was offstage and backstage, and I'm going to get emotional. But, you know, she has only recently graduated from college, and just being able to support her in her journey and offer any sort of advice I might be able to offer to her, I welcome that opportunity, and she's become a sister to me. And to hear, because I'm in a quick change booth as she does her iconic duet, and just to hear her soar and to hear the response from the audience and them loving her, it just makes me so happy and so proud of her. Right. And so grateful that Dan and Brian had the capacity,
yes,
to say, I don't care what race, what they look like, the fact that they're both Asian and they're both the leading ladies in this thing, this piece, she's the best person for the part, so we're just going to do it.
Well, we can also take it a step further, because it turns out that George Xavier,
yes,
who was playing Max
Von Meyerling,
is
fabulously, by the way,
Japanese, has Japanese ancestry.
Yes, he does.
So what is it like to lead this company as playing Norma Desmond?
This is the first in my career. I've covered leads in many shows, but I've never had to lead a company before. And this company has been a dream. You know, they've been so supportive every step of the way, and I need their support in this piece. All of my big moments, they're on stage with me.
Sure.
And they are fully engaged and fully listening and fully holding me up. And I couldn't have dreamed of a better company of people to help.
So can you tell me your three favorite iconic moments of the show?
Let me think. I mean, I guess with one look, that whole sequence, the whole opening sequence where she enters, she's dealing with the loss of a loved one, and then entering into with one look, and then going and putting up her offer to Joe Gillis to work with her and write with her. That whole sequence it's just the two of us. Max pops in here and there, but and it's very big. It's a long sequence. So that's one. I would also say, As If We Had Never Said Goodbye, which is meaningful to a lot of people. Mm. And then I think the finale. The finale with the breakdown and everything. And those are the three moments I think that I would grab from.
Thank you.
our set designer is incredible, David, and so he created this stained glass window.
It's astonishing.
With my face on
astonishing.
And then dozens of photographs, both on the wall and on our console and on small end tables, of me in picture frames. But what it is photoshopped photographs with my face superimposed onto Anna Mae Wong's iconic photographs. So it's her head, her hands, but my face on these photographs. And although it took me a really long time to get used to looking at my face on the walls and in these frames, I remind myself that this is for her. Yeah. And the limitations that were placed on her because she was Asian. And I think about that all the time. And the parallels that we made was that Norma Desmond also was at her peak and height at age 17. Mm. And that's when Anna Mae Wong was first discovered, was when she was 17, mm-hmm. when she had her big break. Mm-hmm. Although Anna Mae Wong was able to make the transition into talkies in a really good way, unlike Norma Desmond. But the parallel that Norma Desmond was kind of removed from the industry because she couldn't transition, right. and because she aged out of it. But that Anna Mae Wong could only reach a certain height because of her being
ethnicity.
Asian, because of her ethnicity. So yeah. that is the parallel that we drew.
Right.
And yeah. First of all, it's a small house. It's 182 seats. I think that there is a real intimate quality to this version of Sunset that you're not going to get, that you hadn't got before, because the other version had, you know, obviously Broadway houses are 2,000 seats. So I feel like you can really connect with these characters mm-hmm. in ways that you couldn't before in
the past. I don't disagree at all.
Because you are really up close and personal with them, with us. And I really do think that this is a revisiting of an iconic piece, but really with a more human... I mean, I want to honor the past because it just is so iconic, but I feel like we bring a lot of heart... and humanity to these characters, or we try very, very hard to. And I know that it's a real, really special thing to have people of color in this piece that's been around for 30 years. I think it's really meaningful.
Until the cameras will start turning.
thank you for joining me for this edition of Backstage Pass with Leah Chang. Come see Sunset Boulevard at ACT of Connecticut. Performances are through November 19th.
Viet Gone sequel, Poor Yella Rednecks, is currently in previews for the off-Broadway premiere at Manhattan Theater Club's New York City Center Stage 1, and will open on November 1st. The cast includes John Hoche, Ben Levin, Samantha Kwan, John Norman Schneider, Maureen Sebastian, and Paco Tolson. I caught a sneak preview and got to visit with the cast on set. I highly recommend it.
It was so gratifying to be back in the wild and wacky world of Kui Nguyen when Susan Murakoshi and I attended a recent preview. Kui, the wildly inventive playwright and screenwriter for Marvel and Disney, known for his use of pop culture, pop music, and puppetry, reunites with his frequent director May Adralis for this funny, sexy, and brash new play. A young Vietnamese family attempts to put down roots in Arkansas, a place as different from home as it gets. A mom and dad balance big hopes and low-wage jobs as old flings threaten to pull them apart. It all makes for a bumpy road to the American dream.
We're gonna thrive in this foreign land, but today we're gonna do whatever we can to create a place where we both can stand. Defying all the haters who say that we can.
I'm climbing these ladders, adapting through disasters. No money in my pocket, but I'm rich where it matters. Won't stop till we've won, son. Swinging for that home run, like the song says in the print. We get the job done.
Poor yellow rednecks, we demand respect. Ain't got a lot of money, but we're still damn perfect. Rise up, son, listen to our reason. We're climbing mountains while the rest of them are sleeping. We demand respect. Ain't got a lot of money, but we still damn perfect. Rise up, son, listen to our reason. We're climbing mountains while the rest of them are sleeping.
From the world of Kui's Viet Gone, with its comic book and action movie influences, comes a play that melds a deeply personal story with the playwright's trademark killer humor. Poor Yella Rednecks has performances through November 26th.
Welcome to this edition of Backstage Pass with Leah Chang. I'm your host, Leah Chang, and I am so excited to be sitting with Brian Kim McCormick, who played my boyfriend in...
Rom-com gone wrong.
Yes.
I was like, that's a mouth. Rom-com gone wrong.
He's in town for a hot minute, but is getting to work on a very special project and decided that we needed to chat about it.
Yeah.
Hi, Brian.
Hi, Leah.
Oh,
great to see you. Thanks for having me back.
I'm so thrilled. So, I understand that you are doing The Sound of Music in October.
I am playing Max Detweiler, and it is at Musical Theater West in Long Beach, California,
So what I find very interesting about the shows you've been doing is you've been hitting a lot of really big musicals.
Yeah.
And I'd like to know what your experience has been compared to the Asian American centric casts and playwrights that you've worked with.
I think for me, the biggest thing is a lot of this material, a lot of these shows are the things that I grew up watching or singing. And as an adoptee, I didn't necessarily have the lens issue about seeing myself represented because I very much identified with the white experience because I came from a white experience. But there is something about now that I identify more with my Asian identity, the importance of being able to be seen and part of those shows that traditionally did not have us. I don't know that there's been a Max who's been Asian before. I think in newer shows when we have representation, authentic, I think that's a different type of representation versus going back to these golden age shows like Hello Dolly, where I got to play Barnaby, or Sound of Music and get to play Max, where we've seen a lot of the same type of casting with other productions, but now we get to see things differently. You know, we've seen Maria's who have been Asian, or Mother Superior's who have been black, or, you know, just a lot more diversity to tell the story, because at the end of the day, the story is what's the connective tissue, not necessarily Maria being a white nun.
Well, one of the other interesting things about your background is you actually grew up in Minneapolis, and you worked with Moo Performing Arts and Theater Moo, so
yes.
You've actually worked with a lot of the Asian American talent in Minneapolis.
Yeah.
You want to speak to that?
Yeah, I would love to. I love the Asian American talent in Minneapolis, and I think it's often a talent pool that's overlooked because Minnesota, along with a lot of the Midwest, is often referred to as the flyover country. And yes,
but
it was started by Rick Shiomi, a Canadian Japanese man who. Japanese Canadian. Thank you.
I know Rick very well.
And he and David Henry Wong are, you know, great trailblazers in our industry. And basically, they're friends. And David Henry Wong was like, I'm going to New York. And Rick was like, I'm going to Minnesota to start an Asian American theater company. It was a play called The Korean Drama Addict's Guide to Losing Your Virginity by Mei-Li Yang. She is a Hmong American playwright, and it was the title that caught my attention to even audition. It's basically a play on like Pride and Prejudice, but set against Hmong and Korean cultures and in Minnesota, and then all that brings with that, being Asian in Minnesota. And Mei is a huge K-drama fan, and so she really brought the flavor and the authenticity to that from her hours and hours and hours of watching. But honestly, it was so pivotal to me in my career because it was the first time I was playing a romantic leading man.
Mm-hmm.
And
romantic lead.
Yeah. Well, you know, again, once I put on the character, yes, the character can feel all that stuff.
Okay, lots of comedy, but still, hello.
But yes, no, it was good. And you're right, though. I think
it gave you a different level of confidence, didn't it?
It did, and I think that's the most important thing. I think everybody, no matter what you look like, who the character is, but we all deserve to feel that type of sexy, power, yumminess. It's, you know, yeah, it's a good thing. So I'm very grateful that role was even created, that I got to originate it. I would revisit that play in a heartbeat. And yeah, it kind of just, that was also kind of the start of my, oh, we can do plays and musicals and go back and forth. So I feel very fortunate about that.
In addition to being an award-winning filmmaker, I know that you're also working on a documentary of going home and finding your roots.
Yes, that documentary has taken many journeys and iterations. It looks like it's coming back down to being a solo trip of my own, but I think that's also okay. I think
adoption is very personal. And I think whenever you bring in other people's stories mm-hmm. and wanting to be respectful about mm-hmm. their journey, it can just... And our, my journey with my friends, it never got messy. It was just that it was hard. I have friend, you know, Daniel May was one of them who we were looking at going back. But he's, you know, off doing shows all the time. Shows all the time. Our other friend, Carrie Lee Cartwright, she was our third member. She's busy all the time. So I think should it line up perfectly for the three of us, we would do it, the three of us, mm-hmm. easily. But I think to just see it through, I need to just focus on my part of the story. So who's here? I've actually, as I've gotten older now, I'm starting to think a little bit more about how much I need to either find my parents or information for my own journey, but also how big of risks do I need to take in getting some of this information, because we're running out of time a little bit. And as you and some viewers might know, I may have a celebrity dad, and I have connections to that celebrity dad now who I have reached out now and been like, would you be willing to maybe forward a letter? Even, you know, so we'll see what happens. But it just meaning that, like, yeah, I'm getting older and I need some answers. So we'll see what happens. Make for a great movie.
Yes. So what does it mean to you to be an Asian theater maker in this time?
I think being an Asian American theater maker in this time is a really big responsibility, and I don't take it lightly, and I celebrate it because, again, we all get to tell stories that we were not included in before, and also we have this rich diverseness of storytelling available. But I think in getting caught up in my own achievements and being able to go after my own career, we also have to continue to look back and lift up everybody who is on this journey with us. I look at people like you, your colleagues and contemporaries who have not only continued your own professional careers, but like made sure that we also feel welcomed. I've always felt welcomed by you and your projects. And, you know, there are many people like you, Bjork Lee, Nina Zoe Lam, Stephen Ang, like the Knapp family made me feel very welcomed getting here. And now, you know, now that I have a little, I wouldn't call it clout, but I can introduce people, and that's my biggest thing that I love to do is like, oh, you want to do this, let's bring you all together. And so I think the more we think collaboratively, the stronger we can be as an American Asian American movement here.
Well, thank you for joining me for this edition of Backstage Pass with Leah Chang.